So, we're going to present you some of the results we have so far in this initial part, in the first year of the project, and some of the comments, some of the comments for PCBs, generally POPs that have been collected on the pellets and fragments we found in the sea on the strand on beach. But first of all, we'll start a general approach to the project to see what justifies this work. And that's in 1970, for the first time, it was noticed that plastics may be a problem. And then it was not very favorite opinion. 40 years later, it's a top issue. And this is not only because of the what we've seen that is happening to the animals in the sea, but it's slowly we understand that the problem is reaching us, and in a very severe way. Now, plastics generally can affect the ecosystem in a direct and indirect way. Direct way is an injury to an animal and death. Indirect is to actually transfer toxicants to the food web, and the end of the food web is us. We receive them. So we know these are two of the most famous pictures you see on the internet. You see like a poor stork that's been covered with plastic. It's probably going to die because it can fly. And the other is an albatross that's decomposing. So you see it's filled up with plastic cups. Albatross eat the cups. They confuse them for food. Actually, they've seen albatross feeding the chicks with plastic cups. And so you understand that's the direct impact. That's feeding. And then it's entanglement, which is quite often with turtles or other animals, and eventually they may die. We have 1 million marine mammals and seabirds that die every year. That's quite an impact. But another thing that's been recently understood is not the big parts of plastics and the big animals, but also the small ones that really have a serious impact. And that's because small particles are confused for food from small animals, from those that filter the water, those that eat plankton, which is the base in the ecological pyramid. And what actually happens is that if you feed on plastic, you don't take any nutrients, actually, and eventually you die from starvation. Okay, and what makes the problem even worse is that plastics are very durable. And the longer they stay in the environment, the larger is the chance for an animal to encounter such an item and feed on it. So, indirect impact comes, as I said before, from the chemicals that enter the food web. Okay, so PCBs and PA hydrocarbons have been found that can be sorbed on the surface of the plastics, and if they stay for very long, the densities on the pellets and the fragments can be about 1 million times larger than it is in the surrounding water. So it's actually packages of toxicants. And as I said before, some of the animals eat them. So if we have what we suspected so far, and slowly it's been proven, if we have biotransfer, that means the chemicals pass from the plastic to the live tissue, then we start having a problem, because feces, mostly, I'm saying feces, other animals too, but we do eat the feces, that feed on these plastics, besides being deprived from the food, they are polluted themselves. They have the chemicals in their bodies, and they go to the food web. And as we go up the food web, bioaccumulation leads to biomagnification, and usually, by magnification is found in the very tasty fishes we go after, like tuna fish or swordfish, which are very commercial. Now, this is a very worldwide problem, has been seen. This is what has been found for POPs, for PCBs on stranded pellets and fragments of small fragments, microplastics in different places in the world. And this is with PA hydrocarbons. Now, confronting this problem, the first thing we've got to do is really assess the problem. We've been talking a lot about how to deal and everything we have to do with plastics, but we don't really know the dimension of the problem. So the first thing is really we have to do is to see how strong and how urgent is the problem and all the work we're going to do. And assessing the problem is quantification. First of all, we have to see how much of the plastic is in the sea, how much is moving around, and what dimensions this is. And then see what type and how many toxicants are carried by these plastics. So we'll have an idea of what their transfer, and eventually find out how much of this is transferred to the food web, and generally how much of this eventually reaches us. And second thing is remediation actions. You have to do something about it, which is projects like this. And then we have to suggest legislative measures to actually confront the problem once we do know how urgent, how big it is. Now, in our work, first of all, in Crete that we've been working on, we looked around the place to see the extent of pollution. Crete is heavily polluted because it actually stands in the way of the currents. You'll see here there's a south current moving northwards and then goes up in the Aegean and then moves down. Along the way, it just sweeps all the garbage and brings it down to Crete. Periodically, there are different eddies formed, like the ones you see in the left picture, which capture actually garbage, and after some period, they just disappear because they're seasonal, they're not permanent eddies, and release them on the island. So Crete is actually like an obstacle, it's a barrier to the transportation of garbages in the Aegean. So after doing, this is a slide you've seen, after doing the survey, we chose the six most polluted areas in Crete, three in the east, three in the west. They are affected by different current regimes, so the garbages that are brought there are probably brought from different places. Like eastern Crete, they have found plastic supermarket bags from Turkey, so they actually take a lot of load. This is from east to the west. This is the situation that looks on Mars. Later they clean it up, but that's how it looks on Mars. The onus is probably the heaviest, the most polluted area. You see two piles in back. These piles are garbage. They try to clean up regularly the place, and 1 month later it looks like this. It's probably the one that receives the most plastic garbage or any garbage from all around the island. This is another typical like picture. You have plastic bags that actually break down. So when they try to clean it up, very small fragments will not be picked up. They will go into the sediment. And that's been done every year. Almerida is a place very peculiar. The sand is coated with plastic pellets and fragments for some reason. And Balos is a complete waste. Probably, according to bibliography, receives garbage from Libya, even from Africa and the Ionian. So you see, and that's Thalassana is in the same area. You see, Crete actually receives garbage from all over, from North Aegean, from east, from south, from the west. It's in the middle of current circulation. So categorization, we focused on pellets and small fragments. There are several opinions about the categorization. We eventually chose the most popular one, which is focused on fragments, on pellets and small fragments that are smaller than 5 millimeters, and these are the ones we collected in this initial procedure. So from each side, we collected from the beach the pellets and small fragments, sieved the sand, and made the sorting, good sorting in the lab, and kept them in the fridge to avoid any further change on the chemicals. The analysis was done for PCBs and PA hydrocarbons, and it was done on aged pellets. Aged pellets, usually the pellets you see here probably were white originally. supposedly, it's the photo-oxidation and chemicals they have encountered in the years they've been in the sea that changed the colors. So we're not 100% sure for this, but certainly these are aged pellets. And since they're aged, the chance that they have pollutants on them is higher. The protocols we use are the ones you see below. And the results for PCBs are the ones you see here. As you see, the lower chlorinated, we have PCBs were found in almost all of them. But higher chlorinated we found only in sample site 3. This is the only site that is close to an urban area. All the other sites were in rural. So this is close to a harbor and to a naval base. The same picture we have also for PA hydrocarbons. Well, as you see on the left, all of the chemical compounds found on pellets are carcinogenic, and some of them are responsible for teratogeny. So, as I said before, these are found in concentrations 1 million times more than it's found in the water. So if there's actually biotransfer, then we have an issue. And sample site 3, which is Almerida, which is in a bay, we have the highest concentrations of this. So just looking at the map, this is for PCBs. The red circle, the big red circle is Almerida, is where we found the largest concentrations. This is close to a harbor, the naval base. The other are far away from areas like this. The same thing with PA hydrocarbons. Another interesting look would be in the ratios that sometimes they have been used in order to find the source of pollution, if it's pyrogenic or if it's petrogenic. So from our results, these are what the ratios in this case, that's what we looked at. In our results, we have that in Almerida, which had the highest highest densities of pollutants, the source is probably pyrogenic, while in the other areas, except sample site 6, which is completely to the east, and it's the only site there, are probably pathogenic. Sample site 6 had a mixed origin of pollutants. So this is for the preliminary result. And the next steps in our work would be first to quantify the problem, as we said before. We'll try to do, to find out how much, what's the density of all these fragments and pellets in the beach and in the sea surrounding these areas. We'll try to look at this in a temporal and in a spatial scale, where we want to see how these plastic debris approaches, if there's a seasonality, and the most important, to see how they're dispersed, not only on the surface, but how they're dispersed in depth. Because once they get deep inside the sediment, then they're probably going to stay there forever. Besides, there are a lot of animals that live inside the sediment, which we have no idea how they will be affected by the plastics or the pollutants that the plastics carry. The other thing is intend to do is to work a little bit more on POPs, since we found that an urban area has a different density of chemicals in it. We chose two more urban areas. To be more certain that actually happens, a thing like this happens, and urban areas really pollute, with such chemicals, the water. And after we receive the results from the other partners of the project, we're going to do a pilot experiment for validating the results for the strains, and then we're going to conclude by testing the whole thing in the actual environment, doing the whole thing in the sea, and see how this thing works out. Now, general mitigation actions we have to take, in speaking in general, for facing the whole problem with pollution is, first of all, we try to assess the problem, as we said, because assessment is the key action when we have a problem. We have to know what the problem is and how urgent, how big it is, so we'll know how urgent the actions are. And we have to monitor, as we said before, for every plastic and see how this thing, how extended is the pollution. And then we have to assess the pollutants that's been transferred by them. Then we have to find ways to collect it, which is quite tricky and difficult. We cannot really collect microplastics or small fragments from the sea. Filtering, because they are about the size of plankton, okay? You cannot filter the water, you will filter all the animals that are in the water. So you cannot do anything for microplastics, but you can do something for the source of microplastics, which are the big pieces that are really in the water. And one idea would be to work with trawlers. Trawlers, actually, the big ships that fishing boats that sweep the floor. My personal experience is that they bring a lot of garbage on deck. Sometimes they're very frustrated themselves because they have to find the fish among the garbage. They would be eager to work and collaborate in taking this garbage out. Usually they just throw them back in the water because they can't do anything else. And that would be a good idea, but it's not that easy. That has certain implications that really have to be thought about. And the third would be to find measures, which that's easier to do, actually, to reduce the influx of plastics in the environment. The first is to go to the landfills and make certain, either by legislation or finding measures that make certain that no escapes will be there from the landfills, that we have no garbage living there. And also, the other thing with the pellets is the source of these pellets in the sea is first from accidental losses from cargo ships. As they carry them, there may be an accident and some millions of them will go into the water. But also, there's poor handling in the factories. If the workers, for instance, are not very careful, a lot of this will go out. Eventually, this will reach the sea. It'll go in the process. It won't die. It will just stay for 10, hundreds of years, and sometime it will reach the sea. So, careful handling there or proper legislation will maybe mitigate a little bit the problem. And the other thing that's been discussing a lot is microplastics, microgranules that have been used in cosmetics. This is actually nanoplastics. A lot of them will reach the drain, eventually the sea. And what's going to happen is that they are going to do everything that's been done before. Fishes are going to eat it. All, everything that filters water, which is all the clams, which is the small fishes, will just eat them. So maybe prohibition would be a good idea. And eventually, something that is more feasible, because taking all these measures is quite difficult, is to have actions like, you know, that this program is aiming in finding ways to biodegrade plastics and eventually remove them from the environment and do this in a very quick way, if possible, or develop special plastics that may be 100% biodegradable. Fragmentation actually is not a solution, it is a problem, because fragments will carry pollutants to the food web. That's what's been understood so far. So we have to find biodegradable plastics and find ways to biodegrade plastic. Well, thank you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much again for a very interesting talk. And this talk gave us a little bit more information about what's going on in seawater and what kind of bioremediation methods should we use in the future to make sure that there is no more problems. Any questions?
I really enjoy your presentation and I am very much impressed, I think, at all of us, what you said only on the region where you evaluated. On my way to this conference, I read in the media that the problem is much more complicated because the islands of plastic are localized in various areas of the oceans also. My question is, what is your opinion about the monitoring of the real situation with these floating plastics in the sea and oceans, because then we can estimate how serious the problem really is.
Are you talking about the oceans or the Aegean? Not the Aegean Sea, generally. Well, monitoring is necessary more than anything. As we have to see what the thing is, we have to see the dynamics, actually. Because a plastic bag, for instance, that will go in the water, it will float, and if a turtle will not eat it, because they look like jellyfishes, and that's what turtles eat, jellyfish, they look a lot like jellyfishes, so the turtles attack the plastic bags and eat them. So if it's not been eaten, then, or by a whale, it will go down eventually, it will start sinking, because animals, biofilm, will start growing on it, it will grow heavy, and it will go down. So it's not like a garbage, you throw it and that's it. It has a dynamic in the marine water. And we have to know what these dynamics are. And if we do know, then we'll have a good idea where to target our efforts on at least cleaning up or remediating the environment. Monitoring is essential.
Just one more question.
Thank you for this talk on an extremely serious point and question. I'm missing one thing in your talk. You are speaking about possible solutions for avoiding the problem, but one solution is missing, which is education. And I think that there will be no way to solve this, or to stop it without education. You know, people must realize that when at 5,000 kilometers or 3,000 kilometers of any sea, if they drop a piece of plastic in a river, it will end there. There is no way to stop. And all this plastic will flow into the sea. And where they are is an unknown question. Everything that has been done so far is what is occurring at the surface. And you are probably aware of all the studies that were made on the eastern coast of the US, where they monitored for 20 years the amount of plastics, and the amount is constant. It is constant, despite that every year, okay, there is a dumping of plastic, so the question is where it is going. Is it eaten by microorganisms, or it is fragmented into such small species that nobody is seeing it? And you know that the nets, they are only collecting, 1 millimeter. Everything which is under is unknown, and that's, for me, very worrying.
Well, regarding education, I couldn't agree more. I think we do not know the problem, or we do not want to know the problem. And certainly we have to make aware to the people of how serious the situation is. The problem with the sea is that we don't see the problem. It's not in our backyard. And if we don't see it, we think that's not important. When we will understand the situations, then it's going to be too late. And people that have a plastic cup and throw it out, or don't put it in a garbage bin and throw it outside the garbage bin, do not realize that this plastic cup eventually will go into the sea. It may be 100 years later. 100 years later, this cup is going to be still there, moving around on Earth, finding its way to the sea. And that's something people don't realize. I think education is number one. I haven't put it in here. I didn't want to broaden up the subject. But certainly, if I was going to start somehow, I would start by educating the people and showing the true dimension of the problem. But once we have some scientific results, then we can really speak in a more scientific basis, more accurate of that's the dimension of the problem. That's why monitoring and assessment generally is a key action in approaching this situation.